start as preachers and believers from around the country packed the National Mall.
If there was ever a time in history where we need another big Jesus event, now is the time.
We believe in events, and that's why we're calling for over 1 million people on the National Mall.
We just lift up the name of Jesus. We need to hear from heaven today. That's why we've come.
$1 million is a little crazy, but Nick is a little crazy. And you sure you want to say this publicly? Let's just pray about that.
You will forgive our sins, and you will heal our hands in the name of Jesus, the VIP.
The blue tent has been converted to a cooling tent where persons feeling symptoms of heat illness can find temporary relief.
We want to follow Jesus!
There's potential that we're going to get shut down.
If we were making decisions based on fear, we probably wouldn't be gathering on the National Mall and trying to get 1 million people to come, you know, because that would just be stupid.
In the midst of chaos.
The skies over Baghdad.
The third of the building has been blown away.
A second
explosion.
There is hope. Reset. It's more than just a word. It's a fresh start. A new beginning. It's God's plan for the whole world. But it starts with you. It starts with me. 10 years ago, a movement launched on a college campus in North Dakota.
There's an urgency, guys. Does anybody feel it? We want to tell people about Jesus.
Nick Hall wrote a paper that went viral. Students started meeting to plan an event, inviting thousands to hear about Jesus.
Jesus, he is alive!
When 1,200 students responded to the gospel, they knew they had to take the message to other campuses.
I see you, I love you, I'm gonna come and rescue you, and I'm gonna go to the cross for you.
God was just getting started. They shared that message with 3 million people across the nation.
I'm praying for a supernatural reset button to be hit in your life tonight.
The message of reset was powerful because it is the message that Jesus changes everything. Addictions can be reset. Relationships can be reset. Your past can be reset. Whatever it was, Jesus was offering a reset.
Jesus, I believe, is here tonight, and he's saying, tonight is the night, my friend. If you'll come to me, I want to set you free.
They believe the message of reset belonged on the biggest stages and venues in the world. In 2012, they started praying about bringing this movement to the National Mall to fill the mall for a generation-defining moment.
We believe that in the name of Jesus, there is power.
When I think about the flow of history for Pulse, you know, it started with these campus events where we would go to a campus and we would rally 2,000, 3,000, 5,000 students for one event.
What is Pulse? What is Pulse?
This Pulse thing started actually 6 years ago as a paper I wrote in my college class. We had to write a paper for something we wanted to see happen on campus. It was because there was kids on our campus that were literally killing themselves. And there was kids on our campus that were getting bullied and abused and kids that were literally giving up on life. And so we said as students, he said, man, why don't we put on something that's positive, that can bring hope and a great event, and let everybody know that if you feel alone, you're not alone. There's people that care about you, there's people that love you.
We're not just gonna bring an artist and show up and leave, but we're gonna continue that process of engaging those who have just met Jesus for the first time or restarted their hearts for him, and how that process continues on even after we leave.
Nick is one of the better communicators I've seen of the gospel at any age, and certainly for this generation. I felt like Nick was the strongest communicator of the gospel I'd ever seen.
Nick is a kind of a double-edged sword. You never know which Nick you're going to get. He might be throwing pop cans at your head one day or balls of paper, and the next day he's on his face fervently praying.
I want to welcome you tonight to the largest student-led event in America this year, y'all.
Hey, I don't push your Maserati, Beamer, miserably. Yeah, I wrote a form, that Nissan looks spiffy. Go ahead and doubt us, what you know about us. We ain't got a photo, then we take another ride. We ain't blowing trees, bro, open up my window. I see you popping tags, but you notice why your head is low.
In the Bible, it says that when one person puts their trust in Jesus, there is a big old party up in heaven. Can we make some noise tonight?
Perception of church, it has to be boring, it has to be this, but look at this, these are people who love God and love to have fun.
It's different than jumping in a club and different from the high of drugs or alcohol. This is the Jesus high.
And I ask you to lead my life. Help me to follow you. Help me to live for you.
You know, for the last 15 years, I've just kind of given myself fully to that message and that cause, and just believing that this generation is looking for hope and looking for answers, and there's one ultimate solution.
Together in prayer as we start this day, God, we just give you glory and praise and honor. We lift up the name of Jesus. God, we say that there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. And so, God, we lift up the one name, God, that's above every other name. And Lord, we just say today that you are worthy, that you are holy. God, we love you and we need you. And so, Lord, we just want to begin this day, Lord, in worship. God, we want to begin this day, God, in repentance and just say, God, we want our hearts to be right before you. And so, God, as people are streaming in from around the world, as people are streaming in across the mall walking here, God, we just lift up the name of Jesus. And God, we just pray, Lord, that your glory would fall. Lord, we pray that we would hear your voice today. God, we don't need to hear from some man or some woman. God, we don't need to hear from some band. We need to hear from heaven today. That's why we've come. And so we pray these things in the name of Jesus. And all God's people said,
amen. We've always said since the beginning, if the gospel is supposed to be everywhere, and if Jesus' love is supposed to extend to everywhere, this is our calling as well. So we've wanted it to be big. We've dreamt that way, we've planned that way, we have expected the Lord to move in amazing ways.
We had 50,000 students come out in those first couple of years, and 10,000 responded to the gospel. And it's just been this ride of every year it's grown, every year more events, every year more people coming on the team. what God has called us to do is so much bigger than anything our organization can do.
God can do anything with anyone, anywhere, at any time. And God can do more in a moment than you can do in a lifetime. And when we pray today and we seek the Lord today, we need to remember God can change things immediately. God is impactful, and God wants to change you and impact your life and impact your generation to the honor and the glory of Jesus. And it's in His name that we meet, and it's by His power that we declare to America, Jesus is the answer.
One of the big turning points for Pulse came when our staff did a summer of prayer, where we would spend 1 to 2 hours every morning over the summer in prayer. And one way that I really believe God answered that prayer was by opening the door for Winter Jam.
I just realized there are so many people here.
Everybody knows that we're here for something bigger than a concert. Yeah. And I think that's what's awesome about Winter Jam. It's not about a show, it's not about rock or whatever's happening. There's a greater purpose.
As a musician out here playing your music, you just love to be able to walk out and play your songs and know that somebody is gonna responsibly handle the presentation of the gospel.
Tonight I wanna ask you this. What is it in your life that is standing in the way of you and your relationship with God?
There was really just a spark that this is going on in so many different cities. This movement was happening not only in our backyard, but it was happening all across the country. He got really excited and really was saying, our team needs to be part of this. We need to be jumping in more in what God is doing across the nation.
Pulse was growing. We were doing bigger and bigger events. And yet it just became clear that nothing was big enough. Didn't matter how big the event was. It just kind of was like, but the need was so great. The need to see our nation change and our generation change is bigger than anything that any one group can handle. And so we just started to dream about what would it look like to see a movement of movements.
We believe that awakening maybe even has begun and is here and is happening. And we want to fan the flames of that in every possible way that we can.
Man, we just believe that there's so much hope in this generation, and God is doing so much in this generation. And so we just think, man, what would happen if all these movements pointed in the same direction?
We need a generation of Christians that love the Word of God, that like Daniel, will purpose in our hearts, we shall not defile ourselves. We shall honor God, we shall pray to God, and we want your will to be done. We want your kingdom to come here on earth as it is in heaven. Guys, we do not need to pray for revival to fall out of the sky. God has put revival on the inside of us. God said, I have poured my spirit on the inside of you. What we need is a generation of holy, passionate, on fire Christians that live according to the Word of God and will allow the Spirit of God to flow through our lives into a lost and a broken world. We are the revival we are praying for. It's the Spirit of God on the inside of us. So let's determine to set our hearts on things above, set our mind on things above, to pursue Jesus, to pursue His Word, and take the love, the grace, the mercy, the goodness, the kindness, the gentleness of God to a lost and a broken world. Let's be the light in the darkness. Let's ask God to use us for revival in this land, in Jesus' name. Come on.
So a lot of people don't realize this, but America is a land of revival. From the very beginning of the founding fathers coming here, God has been turning our nation back to Jesus.
Last week, I got to fly into Boston, Massachusetts, and I got to do something I've been dreaming about for a long time. I got to drive these paths of great awakening and revival.
You see, I drove from Boston to this city called Northampton. Northampton in the 1720s was the place where there was a minister by the name of Jonathan Edwards. He began preaching messages from this site that ultimately were the beginnings of what was a great awakening in America. They said that people were turning away from faith as the settlers and the pilgrims came. This dude would preach in a monotone voice, but the Spirit of God was bringing such conviction that people were coming to Jesus left and right. And so in the 1730s and the 1740s, the first great awakening spread, and literally through sermons that happened here and then spread across the colonies, a revival took place. Then I drove from there. I went to a town called Williamstown in Maryland. And Williamstown was a place during the second great awakening, just literally 50 years later, in the early 1800s, late 1700s, again, our nation was turning away from God. And so on this site in 1806, a bunch of guys, Samuel Mills and his four buddies, gathered here under a hay bale and prayed for revival. They said, God, we want to go to the nations. And right here, the American Foreign Missions Movement was birthed. They called it the Modern Missionary Movement. One of the people that was impacted by that movement was a guy named D.L. Moody. 1830s, 40s, tailing off in the 50s was the Second Great Awakening in America, which was a huge burst of faith. So the people who were doing the Second Great Awakening, planning these outreach events, planning these prayer gatherings, they probably didn't know that one of the people who was going to be impacted as a ripple effect was this guy, D.L. Moody. D.L. Moody comes to Christ, gets fired up. He starts some campuses for men and women. There's two schools out here. One is Northfield School and one is Mount Hermon School. And essentially, D.L. Moody started both of these to train up a generation to follow Jesus. This auditorium behind me seats 2,200 people because they had so many of these revival meetings that were happening. And this guy was going to turn out to be the evangelist of his entire generation. Poured out his life to see literally hundreds of thousands, even millions of people hearing about Jesus and knowing Jesus. D.L. Moody said, let's bring college kids together. They brought 252 college kids together, Mount Hermon. They poured into him for a week and they said, well, you're the generation that's gonna change the world. This is the site of the Northfield campus and where D.L. Moody gathered what they called missions gathering in 1886. And so this plaque here is commemorating it. At the gathering, there was 100 students that signed contracts to give their lives for missions.
Literally birthing what is known as the student volunteer movement. Now here's the deal, guys. We can read all about history and that's great. But what I want you to feel tonight is this reality that our nation has been in dark places before, and the answer then is still the answer now. And if we're saying in faith, God, we believe that you're going to move, God, we're believing that revival is coming, then I think God is saying, prepare yourself.
One of the characteristics of a revival is that people become aware of the great commission of Christ to preach the gospel, to proclaim the good news to as many people as possible. So evangelism and revival kind of go hand in hand.
It renews the very institutions that create culture, that define society. We can look at the university system, we can look at hospitals, we can look at the legal system in America. All of these great institutions actually have their roots in revival.
You know, there's been revivals that have happened in the past, but our generation hasn't seen that. Our generation doesn't know what it looks like for a whole nation to rally.
We could either spend our time condemning the darkness, critiquing the darkness, whining about the darkness, being depressed about the darkness, or together right now in this place, all together, we can turn on the light in the name of Jesus. America, it's time to turn on the light. Church, it's time to turn on the light. It's time to turn on the light. The light of his truth, the light of righteousness, of integrity, of grace and love. Because every single time light stands next to darkness, light always wins. God bless you. Jesus changes everything.
We really think we need to see a real Jesus movement in our day and the United Gathering. And we talked about, you know, what if we booked the National Mall? And what if we prayed for over 1 million people? And met with Billy Graham about it, met with Robbie Zacharias about it, met with, you know, the heads of ministries, the heads of crew, the heads of InterVarsity, the heads of Youth for Christ, met with a bunch of artists about it. Every person we talked to was just like, oh man, this needs to happen. But it's hard to get people's attention to say we're really going after this thing.
You have to have people catch the vision, churches and ministries from around the country saying, why should we be a part of this event? And you need to cast that vision to them and allow them to think about it and to take it in and to realize that this is a once in a generation moment for the church.
I think there is power in numbers. In American history, how many people have gathered before? What is possible? When people look at historic moments, typically they look at large gatherings because it's people uniting and they're coming together for one cause. In fact, you could say that a big concert or a sporting event, unlike anything else, unites humanity, and there's a glimpse of heaven because we're going to be doing that forever.
You can't look at an event. You have to see the hinge of what that event can bring about. More than anything else, what is it that young people need? Truth with relevance. They don't want an abstract truth teaching. They want to know how this is relevant. Once you give them truth with relevance, then they move to certainty and hope and inspiration. When you give them certainty, when you give them hope, when you inspire them, they're the catalysts that go out there and make the difference.
Events work because there's just something about being together that really just changes how you feel about the event and about the world.
Even if it's just one person whose life has changed, to me, it's worth the headaches or the logistics or the money that you go through to put on a big event, especially when it's an outdoor event, open air, that people who are wandering by can just show up for.
You can't imagine the impact on a teenager or on a young 20-year-old who suddenly realizes he's not alone, that he's here with 100,000, 200,000, 500,000 people or more that are all standing for Christ. In the middle of a society where people don't care about spiritual things, suddenly you see people who are passionate about knowing Jesus and making him known to others. And an event that lifts up Jesus will keep on paying dividends for the next half century.
I don't think these type of things, you know, in recent years have happened. And the openness and receptivity for leaders and pastors of different denominations, backgrounds, and that being willing just to come together and kind of put all that denominational stuff aside.
God has caused the gospel to speed ahead, to move rapidly in a observably powerful way. But I think it requires leaders who believe that's possible.
If there was ever a time in history where we need another big Jesus event, or where a Jesus event could springboard the Church of Jesus Christ into another whole great awakening, now is the time.
And you gather this many people in this place for such a specific purpose. Maybe it's just to be sent to show people what it looks like to need Jesus Christ. Maybe that's the most powerful witness we could ever be, is on our knees showing people, this is what it looks like when you need God. And imagine if tomorrow you guys go home and you go to church, and what if you sang a little bit louder? What if you prayed a little bit louder? Not so that people would look at you, so that you could say, man, this is how much I need God, that I'm willing to embarrass myself with the quality of my voice. So let's all witness to God together and sing together. Teach my song. Teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, it's when I cannot stand up full of you, Lord. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Sing it out, church. Lord, I need you. Your voices, sing it out. Lord, I need you. Oh, I
Since I got on the planet, everything has told me that I'm an individual, and I just pulled myself up by my bootstraps, and I can do anything I want to do, you know? And what you find out is that we're very connected to one another. Community and relationship seems to be a central portion of the gospel.
And I think it's powerful for the body to come together as one voice and just cry out in agreement in who he is. And I believe when we're in agreement with who he is and we're praying that back to him, like, it's shifting things.
We're here to represent unity in the church. Yeah. That's basically what it comes down to.
If you believe in Jesus, if you believe in the Word of God, then you're invited to have a place at this table and to have a part in this gathering.
The different voices come together to speak to the power that is in Jesus' name, to the uniting grace that is available through Jesus Christ. It brings a sense of wholeness and shalom that only God can be able to give to our world and generation.
You know, there's people who are afraid about uniting with others. So for some, that might be the Lutherans, for some, that might be the Catholics, for some, that might be the Charismatics. I think there's just all kinds of divisions that often define us. And so for some people, they just don't want to do that.
I think it's really easy in the day and time in which we live to sort of fall back and in some ways entrench ourselves. This is what I believe, but it becomes more of a statement about this is what I'm against and not so much a statement about this is what I'm for. And that's the thing that I think the world needs to see more than ever. It needs witnesses to show what it looks like to make peace.
This is a time more than ever to stand united, to rally under the banner of Jesus.
We just recently, Nick, you, I, and a bunch of pastors from America went to go and visit Pope Francis, and we had an amazing time. This is Matteo Calisi from Italy, and he worked with the Vatican for almost, well, three successive popes, and he's here to just share his heart for unity with you.
Siamo grati al Signore per questa opportunità di adorare insieme in unità.
We're so grateful to the Lord to be together here to worship in unity.
Perché quando cattolici, evangelici, pentecostali,
when Catholics, evangelicals, Pentecostals
adorano insieme,
worship together,
le nostre differenze non salgono al cielo.
Don't go up to heaven.
Siamo uno in Cristo.
We're one in Christ.
Gesù ha detto, quando sarò innalzato attirerò tutti a me.
Jesus said, when I am lifted up, I will draw all men to myself.
Quando noi innalziamo il nome del Signore,
when we announce the name of Jesus,
quale unico Signore, Salvatore,
Messia, that he is the one Lord and Savior,
siamo attirati all'unità.
We are attracted to unity.
E anche noi cattolici siamo venuti a dare questa testimonianza.
And we, even Catholics, have come to bring this testimony.
Had the chance to travel to meet Pope Francis, the Vatican. Just one of these things we've been praying for. That God would open up a door with the Catholic Church.
Can I give you a hug?
But then when we're there being told we're gonna shoot the video that Pope Francis is going to be recording.
Well, we didn't bring a videographer with us, and so we're wondering, okay, how are we gonna do this? I guess we're shooting it with Nick's iPhone, a 6S.
Which isn't typically maybe how I would think of shooting a video with the Pope, but they are 4K now, so, you know, that works.
Together.
I was really impacted by just being around somebody like that. It was definitely an encouraging thing of seeing how God is working in the midst of opposition, in the midst of hardship, in the midst of division. God is opening doors.
Al gran encuentro de todos los jóvenes en Washington para encontrar a quien puede darte una respuesta de esta inquietud. Yo te invito a que te pongas esta malla para que te revistas un día con esto y puedas responder a esa gran inquietud.
I think, you know, we just live in probably one of the most divisive times ever in human history. And it's a weird sort of divisiveness too, because every other time there's been division, unfortunately, it's erupted into conflict, like visible conflict. And now what's dangerous about the time in which we live is that it's all this division that people primarily carry around within their own hearts. It lives and sort of seeps around the internet.
When the people of God come together,
The enemy is not happy at all. So you're going to get attacks from all ends.
And so here we are with worldwide problems, talking about everything except what the real problem is. We don't want to talk about the human heart. And the reason we don't like to deal with that is because we don't like to use the term evil and sin. We'd rather call it anything else. And so what do we do now in politics? We talk about right and left, and we're always at each other's throats because we've forgotten there's an up and a down.
When hard times happen, we jump to the conclusion of saying the enemy's winning. We're being pushed out. God's being pushed out. But I think we're missing the point. God can't be pushed out. You can't push God out. And so I think God is resetting our hope from politics to heaven, from education to heaven, from institutions to heaven, from money to heaven, right? From things of this earth to things that are coming.
The same power that rose Jesus from the grave, the same power that commands the dead to wake, lives in us, lives in us. Thank you, Jesus. The same power that moves mountains when he speaks, the same power that can calm a raging sea, lives in us, lives in us. He lives in us, he lives in us.
All right, everybody, can we make some noise for Jesus on the National Mall in Washington, D.C.? What I'm talking about. Is anybody excited to be here right now? Does anybody believe that our God is alive and that God is moving and that Jesus is here? Man, we're praying. We're so excited. I want to welcome you again to Together 2016. You're going to hear this all day. We believe that Jesus changes. He changes everything. So if you're posting, tweeting on Facebook, use the hashtag. We want to get it trending around the world. We want one name lifted up today. It's not any name on this stage. It's not any name of a band. It's not any name in the crowd. There's one name. What's that name?
Jesus.
That's right. We want to lift up that name. And so all day long, we're going to be lifting up Jesus. And you're going to be hearing this message throughout the day of reset. Say reset. You see, this whole thing started with a prayer. Literally 5 years ago, God laid this message on my heart that God was offering a reset to America. And so I packed up my family in an RV, and we went across the nation and said, we're going to plan the largest Jesus gathering of our generation. We're going to pray that the National Mall would be filled, and we want to announce that Jesus is offering a reset. Does anybody believe that? Now, I want to tell you, I'm just a guy from North Dakota, and I hope that as you see me up here, you think, man, if God can use that guy, he can use anybody. I hope you think that, because listen, God wants to use you. He wants to use you, and we're praying for a reset. Now, we have reset prayer walls today where you can stop and you can lift up a reset prayer. Say, Jesus, reset my faith. Jesus, reset my addiction. Reset my family. Whatever it is in your life, God offers a reset. Amen?
September 2013, we launched our 30-plus city tour. We did about 36 events across America, and the actual beginning, really, of Together 2016 was that tour.
We're just standing out here, just rolled out of the bus. As you can see behind us, this is what we affectionately call the Jesus Mobile, talking about Reset, the largest Jesus gathering in America's history.
And so as we went across the country, praying for this tour, praying for this country, praying for the church to be united under Jesus and not divided about all these different issues. I was so happy to just get to be there where I knew I was meant to be, to pray for the city I was in, to see God move in power and heal hearts and heal the souls of people that were so wounded.
We knew we were gonna do multiple cities. We'd hoped for about 1,000 people per night, and we had some events that were well over 1,000 a night, and we had some others, even in iconic venues like Boston, where revival was birthed, where we literally only had probably 20, 30 people.
Yeah, I mean, you see a room like this, it's just so incredible.
And you think, what would it look like to be packed for people coming to pray for revival and that God would move?
Just want to thank you for coming out tonight, man. It was just awesome. It's just so exciting to be here, be a part of this movement. It's gonna be the most epic worship event. Look at this. We're in Boston. Revivals happen right around here. I want you to look around. You're part of the few. We get to be in this venue. We're gonna pack it out. Remember, Jesus chose 12. God, you're gonna move. It's gonna be awesome. You know, the disciples, they whittled them down to the 7. Gideon, he had just his 300. Hey, what's up, everybody? I know we don't have 300, but hey, we can start. Anybody out there? Hey, Mom. No, my mom didn't even come. Man, nobody came. We were flyering out in front of the church before, trying to get people to come in. I think we probably had like 20-some people on the tour with us, and I bet there was 20 people that came.
I remember standing outside on the steps of Tremont Temple Church, and Nick walks up to us, and he's just looking. We're all just looking out on the city of Boston, and Nick's like, what are we doing? You know, I'm going around counting all the volunteers to be like, oh no, guys, there's 50 people here. There's 50 people here if we count volunteers.
It was a difficult experience because we knew God had called us to this. We knew we were supposed to be out here doing it. We're in this iconic venue in Boston, and ultimately, we have like crickets.
Standing up on that stage and saying, we're gonna get a million people on the National Mall. If every one of you brings 50,000 friends, it can happen. That was the low point.
My view of the whole thing was, you said you wanted to just follow where the Spirit led, and who knows what will happen when you do that. You're gonna be in places where your faith's gonna have to be big. If not, why are you doing this? There's no room for faith if everything goes the way we planned, you know?
It's seriously really hard for me to even explain being in here. Like, it really is just super emotional. I feel like this room for me represents so many of the dark moments of the last 3 years. You know, the funny thing is that it could have been packed out that night to the rafters, which still just gives me chills thinking what that would look like in this room. It could have been packed out, and maybe then we would have believed. But our faith would have been in the people. Our faith would have been in momentum or a crowd or hype. But when you're sitting in a room and standing in a room and nobody's there, and you're praying for revival, the only thing you have to put your hope in is God.
My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Do you remember King Jehoshaphat in the Old Testament leading God's people? And a messenger came to Jehoshaphat and said, there's an army coming against us. But it's worse than that. Now, from another direction, there's another army coming against us. And it's worse than that. From another direction, another army is coming against us. Have you ever been to that place in life where it was one thing and you were saying, God, help me with that thing, with that challenge, with that trial? And while you were trusting God to help you with that trial, another thing came from the other side, and you're like, God, we're just trying to solve one dilemma today, and now it's another thing happening. Anybody ever been in that place before? Like, we're dealing with divorce and now we got cancer. We're dealing with cancer and now there's an accident. We're dealing with death, but now financially we're in trouble. And when two or three things start coming at us at once, what do? Well, we look back to Jehoshaphat. What a brilliant move as a powerful king. He gathered the people. That's what we've done today. And he had all the people bow down before Almighty God. And he made a confession that is a brilliant confession for a leader to make. He said, Lord, we don't know what to do, but our eyes are on you. And you know what Jehoshaphat did next? He said, okay, get the army ready. You would expect that if there are three armies coming. But then he said, get the worshipers, get the choir, and put the choir out in front of the army. And when we go out to battle tomorrow, the choir is going to go first. Now, can you imagine being on the worship team that day and you were thinking, wait a minute, we're musicians. We don't know how to fight. We're musicians. We don't really, you know, we're not strategists. We're just the artist. And he said, yeah, well, today, the artist, the worshipers, the musicians are going to go before us into the battle. And the people who were in the army were like, yeah, I like that. Let's put the choir out front today and give them a shot. But Jehoshaphat knew that worship wasn't an ancillary part of the economy of God, that worship is a weapon in the economy of God. And worship breaks open the darkness and ushers in the kingdom of light. And so when we're singing today, it is a weapon of our praise. And so out went the choir, and do you know what they sang? It wasn't like an 18-verse hymn. It was a simple song they sang. Their song that day, facing three armies who were against them, was, give thanks to the Lord. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord. His love endures forever. So we're not looking at three armies. We're looking at a great God. We're not looking at the foe. We're looking at the one who made heaven and earth, and we say, that's where our help comes from. There's an army behind us, but our hope is in the Lord.
Together is huge because it's people from all over the nation coming together around Jesus. We don't know if there's going to be 100,000 people or 1 million people or 10 million people, but we know that it's going to be something that hasn't happened in a generation.
They're just praying and seeking God's face that He uses this day to truly just bring about an awakening and bring about revival here in America.
One of the great things is what happens among those that are putting the program together, putting the whole event together. They end up doing things far beyond their own abilities, and for the first time in their lives, they grasp that God can actually work through me.
We're believing for over 1 million people on the National Mall as we come together for an event called Together 2016. We're going to be praying for the nation. With all that's going on in this nation, we believe that there's a real need, but we believe that Jesus changes everything. Anyone else believe that?
Together 2016 is going to be the largest Jesus gathering in American history. More than 1 million people at the National Mall, Washington, D.C. for one day, united under the banner of Jesus.
So I think I first heard Nick start talking about D.C. several years ago.
Started to hear rumors of all these people coming together to worship Jesus on the Mall in Washington, and obviously it sounds really exciting.
When I first heard about this, I think it was a combination of a couple things. I think it was a combination of Twitter, different friends that I know that said, hey, we just got invited to this event on the National Mall. It's called Together. Having a heart for unity, I've just been praying for it long before I was ever asked to be part of it. So now to be able to go and be part of it is very special for me.
First time I heard it was actually from Shelley Giglio. She was telling me, here's the deal. It's going to be this massive event on the National Mall, and you got to be a part of it. And as soon as I start digging into the thing, I'm like, oh, done. I am there. All my friends are there.
I've heard about this for a long, long time. I love this guy. He's passionate. And we also have a lot of other people that share that same passion. And I believe something is going to shift on July 16th.
You and I, we aren't that different. In our hearts, we know that division is tearing us apart. It's killing us. We watch as our generation turns its back on the church. Many burned by her judgment, few seeing her love. Something needs to change, and many believe it's too late. But we are the ones who believe. We believe Jesus changes everything. He changed you. He changed me. He can change our nation. True belief is demonstrated when we act. To lift the sound, to reach out, to come together with anyone who believes. Shattering barriers that have kept us apart. On July 16, 2016, we're calling over 1 million people to meet on the National Mall to stand for Jesus in historic unity, prayer, worship, and a call for catalytic change. We are one family, one nation, together, who believe.
I don't think there's anything that I can cite that has the capacity to literally change a nation like Together 2016.
Here's what I really believe. I think what's going to happen in an event like this, you're going to see this thing multiply in ways that you can never imagine.
I expect that people will come together in a way they never have before, that people will actually lay aside differences, whether it's denomination or politics, and that they'll really, truly be united as the church.
Now's the time. Now's the time to come together. We've been praying, God, you've done it before. Do it again. And why not now? Why not, right?
You know, we live in a time when obviously there's a ton of fear around everything. Well, there's fear around violence. There's fear around, you know, just whatever. And yet I think those are the very things that we're trying to confront with this gathering. But obviously, if we were making decisions based on fear, we probably wouldn't be gathering on the National Mall and trying to get a million people to come, you know, because that would just be stupid. We're just praying that God would move, and we're just believing that he's got our backs.
I think that's what Nick is doing, is just trying to lift up the sails and just say, man, God, this thing is only going to move if you blow. And so Together 2016, the Reset Movement, it's just us kind of doing our part to say, God, we're here. God, we're ready. God, we want to see you move. And nothing is going to happen, God, unless you do it.
What we need in our day is something only God can do. We need God to heal our land. I just believe from the beginning that this is an invitation for a nation to be reset. It's an invitation for us to come to Jesus. I really believe that there's something about rallying a nation together. And so we're praying, we're dreaming, we're believing God for over a million people on July 16th.
Hey guys, we're here at Together 2016 in Washington, D.C. on the Mall.
Hundreds of thousands of people filled the National Mall for prayer and a message of unity. It's called Together 2016.
Michael W. Smith will take the stage with more than 40 recording artists and speakers.
Some at Together 2016 say harmony in our country is needed now more than ever.
Here we go. Lest the Lord builds a house, we labor in vain. So God, build the house.
There was a time of prayer that I had backstage before the event began with Michael W. Smith. And we were praying and just crying out to God. And all of a sudden, I think they let the crowd in because the crowd just started to erupt. And we both just started crying in our prayer. And it was honestly like just one of those like moments where it's like you just know that God is right there with you.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior. The hope of nations. Yeah.
Heard a choir singing.
Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save.
But I still always had that bit of angst of, okay, Lord, who are you going to bring? He's called us to this. We're going for it. They'll show up. We just need to keep doing what God's called us to do and do it well.
There was a conversation we had backstage on Facebook Live where it was Tim Tebow, myself, Jeremy Camp, and Robbie Zacharias, and it was super powerful.
It's that your life is significant. God has a special plan for your life. We can
and just seeing unity across races, across generations, across ages. Like, I just think, like, God's all over that. Man, just sitting backstage listening, and when Kirk Franklin got up there and prayed.
And God will put on this earth not to be celebrities, not to be stars, but God, we're to be servants to each other. We're to love each other unconditionally. God, I pray before you, make me the husband and father that you call me to be. Let me die for Tammy. Let me die for Carrion, Carrington Kennedy, and Keziah. Let me die for my home. Let me die for my community. Let me die for a white man. Let me die for a black man. Let me die for an Hispanic man. Let me die for an Asian man. Let me die for every man. Let me get out of the way so that you can be God in my life. And if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek your face, you will forgive our sins and you will heal our land in the name of Jesus, the VIP, Jesus the headliner, Jesus the superstar, Jesus the King of Kings, Jesus the Lord of Lords. And everybody make some crazy noise right now.
And it was just, you just feel the power and the presence of God. You know, when Lecrae prayed earlier in the day, and then during their set, and just the servant heart that everybody had.
Father God, give us the eyes to see, the ears to hear what your heart beats for. Give us humble hearts, Lord God. Open our eyes to see, Father God, where we do not line up with you. Let us not be so vain to believe that because we have assembled, that is enough. No, Father God, help us to search our heart. Lord, search our heart, Lord God, and allow us to see internally what we may be missing, what we are not seeing, that everyone across the nation feels included in this gathering. When your word tells us how to pray, it doesn't say, go and speak to your father, go and speak to my father. It says, our father. It's collective. We are a family. Let us pray as family, God, coming together saying, we care about one another. Our desire is to do your will on this nation, on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen.
People were hearing about Jesus literally every probably 3 to 5 minutes at least. Jesus was the one that was being pointed to.
Our beckoning to reverse, to turn around and face Jesus.
That Jesus, in fact, changes everything.
Jesus is here.
Set our mind on things above to pursue Jesus.
Jesus.
The name of Jesus.
I went up to Chris on stage and I just said, man, this is awesome. Just the way that everything was coming together, every section of the program, the people that were speaking, the music, everything in my mind was like, this is as good or better than I ever imagined. Show today. We didn't come for a concert. We didn't come to hear from some person. We need to hear from heaven.
We pray today and we seek the Lord today. We need to remember God can change things immediately.
We need a total reset so that we can hear from God again. And he says, if you ask me, I will answer you.
What we declare today is in uncertain times, we are standing on a certain rock, and he is the rock of ages.
There's nothing that can stop him. There's nothing that can stop the name of Jesus.
You're not defined by the hell you're going through. You're defined by the heaven you're going to.
We believe that what a divided nation needs is a united church.
God has a plan to heal this world. And it can only happen through his hands and his feet, and that's us.
We are the church of Jesus Christ, and the gates of hell shall not, will not prevail against us. Father, release the grace of unity across the prayer movement.
I've been in front of a number of big events, 50,000, 100,000, you know, and seen pictures of large events, but I've never been in front of that many people. I think that was the first realization of, okay, this is the biggest event that I've ever seen. I don't think that the authorities believed we were going to have as many people as came. Like, I think they staffed thinking they were overstaffing for 100,000.
I arrived in DC about 10 days in advance of Together because there's final meetings that'll take place. And one of those meetings was with the authorities and they were suggesting a fence around the entire Washington Monument. I had let the captains know that if we need to put the fence up and you tell me I have to, I am absolutely gonna do so. Well, the forecast called for it to be quite hot that day. And when you put fences around things, people are less likely to leave. They don't want to go away to actually take care of themselves as much.
The fence was a curveball. There was really a resistance to seeing it happen because I think they could see a lot of the issues that it was going to create.
It created a crowd crush at each of the entry points, so we had people wait in line for literally 2 hours.
I've never seen this sort of line for any event I've ever been a part of.
The captain ended up doing was calling me and saying, listen, I want to help you alleviate your crowd crush. He swung the gates wide open to actually allow people to come flocking in.
By early in the morning, their staff and resources were overwhelmed. And so the EMTs are overwhelmed, the entrances are overwhelmed, the whole infrastructure is overwhelmed, right? And so it was just, I think it just created a very uncomfortable situation for everybody.
All right, well, we're gonna continue, but I wanna make a quick, a very important announcement. We have several people who are struggling with heat exhaustion, and so the Parks Commission is kinda getting concerned. I know we're having a great time, but I wanna encourage you guys to use wisdom and make sure you're healthy and cooling off. So I wanted to read this quick message for you guys. It says, based on the current heat index and high number of people requiring treatment from heat-related illness, the public safety authorities have placed cooling buses at 15th and 17th Street. So cooling buses at the 15th and 17th Street access points where you entered. In addition, there are water stations on 17th Street.
Start to walk off the stage and Justin, who's our president, is walking along and I was like, perfect timing. And so I say, you need to come with me. And he's like, great, where are we going? And I was like, well, we're gonna get in the back of this squad and head to the command center.
What do you mean that we're gonna do? And he's like, there's potential that we're gonna get shut down. And it was just my heart sunk.
Justin, myself, the lieutenant for the captain, and Leonard from Parks all head over to the command center. And in there is additional officers, there's EMT folks, and basically sit down and he starts to tell me that he thinks they're gonna have to shut us down at 1600. So I start to, you know, ask about different resources. How do we get further misting stations out? We've opened up our partner's tent for a cooling station so that people can get just the chance to kind of chill in there a little bit. We actually had 7 pallets of water and we're forking those up the channels. We're giving them out to the crowd. So we're actually taking care of folks the best we can.
We have hundreds of thousands of people right now. We're getting water coming in and out. We have ice trucks, literally bags of ice, where people are just coming and grabbing ice and taking it back to their youth groups, their families. We're trying to pass out as much as we can. It's really hot out here.
So we're just trying to figure out how do we get to execute the rest of our program. We've planned years and years for this to be, you know, what takes place. Justin went and grabbed a couple of our board members as I went and grabbed Nick and just started to share the situation with Nick that they're gonna shut us down. And
that was really where the day took a massive U-turn, you know, where it was, they're pulling the permit. They just came into the office and told us we're shutting you guys down at 4. First reaction when Chris said they're gonna shut us down is they can't, you know? Oh, no way, what are you talking about? Obviously, we've been working on this for years and opinions are kind of flying, right? We should do this, we should do that. There was a number of people that thought we should push through, right? And we just need to keep going and make them take the microphone away.
I don't like it. I agree with what you're saying. And I think that, you know, we could push that forward. And I think you know that.
If you recess for a couple hours or six or something,
and I pushed all that. I pushed all that. Justin was there.
I know, basically, they said that we couldn't do that. But if we didn't get that done,
decision that I kind of made is like, okay, let's plan as if 4 is going to be the stop time and let's rearrange the program accordingly.
I don't think it's worth leaving people's hopes up. Like, I think we just have to
think we go till 4, you leave it all on the table.
And, you know, in the context of something that you've been literally dreaming about for years and years, and it's coming into full execution, and then you're being told to shut it down, and then to respond and say, you know, I think that we should probably actually shut it down based on where our country and our nation is. It was fun to see the global leader that I believe God has called him to be.
It's just not worth it. I mean, we're standing, we're representing, I feel like, a lot of people. I just don't think it's the right thing to do.
We're going to stop at 4 o'clock. Production is deciding how to rearrange the last hour and 26 minutes of the show.
Okay, what are the components that we need to have? How are we going to make this fit? Who's off-site that we need to get back?
We laid out that we need to get some of those final acts that we were going to have in the evening, Hillsong, McRae, Francis Chan.
It was the craziest 2 hours of my life of just trying to figure out how to land this plane.
Okay, so literally what we'll do then, how much time do we have?
We currently have an hour and 18 minutes.
Okay. And neither LaCrae or Hillsong are here.
Okay, so we're trying to get here.
Correct.
Okay, so what we'll do is coming out of this, let's send Matthew out.
Okay.
And have him sing maybe one or two songs.
Yeah.
Kind of as a response from the segment.
Okay.
I'll come out under that.
Okay.
Begin to share a message, you keep playing. I'll bring Tebow out.
A lot of people's sets got cut totally short. A lot of people's sets got cut completely, you know, but people were just rolling with it.
We are a city on a hill. Somebody say yeah. But we're never gonna change the world just by standing still. Yeah. But no, we won't stand still. Now put your hands together and sing it with me. Say, come on, if not us, then who?
This literally is a time where who cares if you end up not singing, that you start praying or you start talking, or it's a time where you play one song because the Lord leads you in some direction. This is who cares who you are, you know? And I love that because it doesn't matter who we are. It doesn't matter about which artist is here, which speaker is here. The focus is saying we need more of Jesus.
Right now, we have some instructions to try to wrap this thing early, okay? And so it's not, I know, but here's the deal, guys. We really believe that this whole day is a statement. This whole day is about Jesus. And so here's the thing, we want to honor and respect the authorities that are helping keep us safe here today. So we're wanting to, a lot of the EMTs and first responders are saying so many people have passed out that they're overwhelmed right now. And so we're just trying to get everything we can in as quick as we can.
So, you know, discussions are taking place, like why are we in this position? How did we get here? How do we take this, make it what God has called us to do in this moment? Because this moment wasn't supposed to come for a few more hours.
I just got down on my knees there on stage, partially because I just wanted to get away from everybody and stop hearing every other voice. And I just wanted to clear my own thoughts and ultimately just ask God that he would lead and he would guide and he would give us the words. And I think, you know, in that moment, I'm just praying, God, just help us. God, you're in control. God, give me the words. Help us to know what to do. I think that last 90 minutes in particular was probably some of the most dynamic program that maybe we could have ever planned and would have never planned, right? And it all was in that last 60, 90 minute slot. Tony Evans gets up and gives a commissioning prayer.
To transform this culture, bring healing to our land, hope in time, help in history.
Francis Chan gives his message.
Isaiah 66:2 says, this is the one that I'm gonna look to, is the one who's humble and contrite in spirit and who trembles at my word. And sometimes we spend too much explaining his word and not enough time just trembling at it.
Tim Tebow gives a challenge.
How cool would it be when I leave this earth and I'm standing before the God that created every single one of us, for him to pull off his headsets of running this world and walk up to me with his arms open wide and say, Timmy, I just want you to know, I love you, I'm proud of you, you finished strong.
LaCrae sings a song.
Welcome to America.
Because I've been to the mountaintop.
Welcome to America.
America. Welcome to America.
The whole 116 gets up together.
Come in, pull me.
Give me the mic, better believe I'ma go hard. Coming after everybody with that lyrical, lyrical, lyrical reality. Without an apology, whenever I get up on the microphone, I got the gravity. We dirty up, putting pearls, cooking up. With a rank one blast to record the Mac and the sword and the man can go. And I'm begging the mother with a passion for give me 16, I'm a brag, I'm a lawyer.
I share the message.
This whole day is great. We love music, we love speaking, but man, at the end of the day, the thing that matters most about today is where you are at in your relationship with God. Whether you're at the back of the park, whether you're at the base of the monument, whether you're over there in the White House, whether you're wherever you are, God is offering a reset.
Hillsong gets up, sings one or two songs.
And our hearts they cry, we go real far, we lift it high above all.
Come on.
For you out here, with everything we will shout for.
Think of, you know, the things that I said that I wouldn't have said had not been for that situation. I think those are actually the things that people remembered the most.
Here's the deal. We've been praying for this gathering literally 5 years. Five years. 5 years. This gathering is impossible. Let me just tell you, like, this is impossible. This doesn't happen. Like, this isn't some big organization. This isn't some big group. This isn't some big whatever going on. This is Jesus. This is Jesus. And I just want to tell you right now, listen, as we've been praying for this, it was never about coming to the mall. It's always about being sent from the mall. Let me say it again. This hasn't been about coming to the mall. This is about sending a generation out from the mall who are saying, God, we want to go. God, we want to go. God, we want to go. We want to follow Jesus. We want to give everything for Jesus. We're not afraid of the risks. We're not afraid of the cost. We want to go. And so, Jesus, we just surrender right now to you. God, we just want to seal this moment, God, just this holy moment. We surrender to you, Jesus.
I think I have an incredible sense of peace that God did exactly what God wanted to do. And I think even the statement of praying for and sending out, I think, was probably stronger because of what happened. I think the message of praying for our leaders and authorities, I think, was really clear because of what happened. And so I think God's in control. I mean, it's not for me. This isn't like, gosh, oh man, we're done. It's like, man, look what happened today. What's gonna happen now? You know, nobody knew anything about together before this. What could happen next? And so I'm really full of faith. And I think what we saw today is a generation that was being given faith. And I really hope that churches across America and believers across America can look and see that there's hope for the future, that this generation is wanting to water down truth, isn't wanting to walk away, but that we want to go after God. We want to follow Him at all costs. I really want to give my life to seeing this generation be all in for Jesus. And I think of the sea of faces on the mall and just wanting to help them keep going and go after the dreams that God puts in their hearts. You know, I still feel like a kid from North Dakota who God put this dream in my heart. if God can do this now, then what can he do next year? What can he do in 5 years? What can he do in 10 years? So what's next? We're coming, you know, your city, your country. We got the message and our bags are packed. And we believe now's the time.
Teams? Are we talking teams?
Together.